In this video, we will discuss the Rutherford-Bohr model of the atom. It states that electrons move around the nucleus in well-defined orbits, similar to planets in the solar system. Although it is a mix of classical and quantum mechanics, it does describe the hydrogen energy levels quite well. The model itself is named after the British physicist Ernest Rutherford and the Danish physicist Niels Bohr. The Rutherford-Bohr model relies on three assumptions. First, the electrons move in circular orbits around the nucleus and do not emit electromagnetic radiation, even though, according to classical electromagnetism, an accelerated charge should emit this kind of radiation. Such orbits are also called stationary orbits. Second, these stationary orbits have discrete radii, so it's not possible to be in between two orbits. This can be expressed mathematically via the angular momentum of the electron, which must be an integer multiple of h-bar. Third, the electrons are allowed to jump from one orbit to another by receiving or emitting energy. The exact amount of energy depends on the energy difference between those two orbits. Now let's go into some more detail and assume that we're dealing with a one-electron system. This could be a hydrogen atom, ionized helium or lithium atoms, and so on, as long as we don't have any electron-electron interactions. The electron on its circular orbit is bound to the nucleus via the Coulomb force, such that the centripetal force and the Coulomb force balance each other. In this equation, mu stands for the reduced mass of the electron-nucleon system, and z tells us how many protons are in the nucleus, since this determines how strong the nucleus pulls the electron towards it. We can rearrange this equation to give us the radius of the electron orbit depending on its velocity. At this point, we must make sure that there are only discrete orbits, as mentioned in the second assumption. By claiming that the angular momentum must be an integer multiple of h-bar, we can express the velocity of the electron in terms of this integer n. There's actually another equivalent way to get to this expression. We can claim that the de Broglie wavelength of the electron must be able to fit n times within the circumference of the orbit. In other words, if we draw the wave along a circular orbit, we want the beginning and end to meet at the same point, resulting in a standing wave. Otherwise, this would result in a cancellation of the wave due to destructive interference. And really, this yields the same relation for the velocity. Using this, we can express the radius in terms of n, z, and some constants, which together are called A0, Bohr's radius. This radius is pretty close to 0.05 nanometers and gives us a good approximation of the size of an atom. Finally, let us talk about the energy of an electron in the Rutherford-Bohr model. These energies are important since they determine how much energy an electron must absorb or release in order to jump from one orbit to another. It looks complicated, but it's just evaluating the classical kinetic energy and the Coulomb potential energy using the relations for V and R that we derived earlier. We see that the kinetic energy is in fact exactly -1/2 times the potential energy. So the total energy is simply given by 1/2 times the potential energy. There's again the parameters n and z, as well as some constants, which we call Ry star. This is called the Rydberg constant, named after the Swedish physicist Johannes Rydberg. For a hydrogen atom, Ry star is approximately equal to 13.6 eV. Now we can also state the transition energy from one orbit I to another orbit j. It is simply given by the difference Ej minus Ei, and tells us that if an electron jumps up, it has to absorb energy, and if it jumps down, it releases energy. And that's pretty much it for this video. Thanks for watching.